you don't have a Bible, we have some in the back. If you raise your hands, one of the brothers would rejoice in giving you one. If you don't have a Bible, you're welcome to take it home and keep it. We just ask that you commit to read it. So again, we're going to be in Judges chapter 8. Before we open up the Word, let's begin in prayer. Father, we thank you for your Word. We thank you for giving it to us. Thank you for providing it to us in a language that we can understand. We pray that today as we open it, the book of Judges once again, that your Spirit would illumine our minds, that you would reveal to us Christ in these pages. Lord, we know that all of Scripture points to one thing, and that is your Son. It's in his name we pray. Amen. So as I mentioned, we're back in the book of Judges, and I'd like to begin just with a quick review of where we've been so far as we've been back in the Gospel of John, and as Pastor Jesse's been preaching through there. Now we're going to kind of take a big, about 1,200-year backward step in the time period of redemptive history. So when we do those kinds of things, we need to reorient ourselves, see where we are within this big picture of God's redemptive plan. As we've talked about often, this book of Judges, it begins right after the time period of Joshua. Joshua dies at the very beginning of the book, and then the book ends right before you see the rise of Samuel in Israel, and you see then the ascension of the monarchy there with Saul, and then David and the kings that would follow after that. The time period is about 1350 to 1050 BC, give or take, so we're talking about a time period of about 300 years covered in this short book, so it's a very long time period contextually there. We have to keep that in mind as well. And as we've seen this repeating pattern that we talked about within the book of Judges, but we have to remember that it's not just a pattern so much like a merry-go-round, but it's a pattern that spirals downward and downward and downward as we go just further into apostasy within this book. And the pattern is characterized by, first, Israel apostatizes. They turn away from Yahweh, the true and living God, and they go seeking after the gods of the land, the gods of the Canaanites and the other surrounding countries. Then God comes and lovingly chastens his people. Usually that's through invaders from the outside or from invaders within. And in this case, in Judges chapter 8, we're looking at this time period of the Midianites coming and oppressing the people. This oppression comes, the people cry out to God. And what we've seen is that this is not a crying out that is a repentant, turning from sin, crying out. It's more of a crying out in misery. They're just miserable in their circumstances. And the loving God comes, and even in that case, comes and helps them, comes and delivers them. And what he does is he raises up a deliverer, a judge. Remember we talked about the name Judge is a little bit misleading for us. We think today of somebody in a black robe that sits there and adjudicates cases. And really, these are deliverers that saved Israel from the oppression that they were under. During the time of each of the judges, the judge succeeds for a time, and then a period of peace comes in the land. But then what happens is the judge dies, and then the people turn even more into apostasy. And what this does is it highlights for us the insufficiency of any earthly deliverer, points us forward to this deliverer that's still to come at this point in God's plan. It's the deliverer that was promised way back in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, the seed of the woman who was going to come and crush the head of the seed of the serpent. We've been looking two messages now in Judges chapter 6 and 7, which is the life of Gideon. And today we're going to be in chapter 8, which finishes his account within the book. And what we saw then was the people once again, they turned and did evil what was in the sight of the Lord. They turned and worshipped after the Baals. And then God once again chastens them. The Midianites come in and for 7 years oppressed the land. And the book says they were like locusts, so they basically had stripped the land every year they would come in and basically just wipe everything out. And the Israelites end up living in caves and in the mountains just to avoid this great plague that had come onto the land. Then we see the angels of the Lord coming and calling Gideon. It reminded us of the call of Moses in many ways. And Gideon finally, after some hesitation and some convincing from the angel of the Lord, accepts this call. And then the angel of the Lord, the first thing that he's to do is he's to go and tear down this altar of Baal and the Asherah that is next to it, that's in his father's house. So here we have these altars that within Gideon's family had been erected there. And then what we see is that the Spirit of the Lord, the word says, it came and clothed Gideon. And then Gideon is able to raise up 32,000 men to come and follow after him. And then what does the Lord do? The Lord then reduces the size of those troops all the way down to 300. And basically God tells Gideon, I'm taking these troops down to such a small level so that there can be no doubt whatsoever that it's me that delivered these people and not you. You're not going to get any credit here, Gideon. I'm going to make it obvious to everyone that it's me working here. So then that army of 300 come and attack, not with swords, but with trumpets and jars and the torches. And then they come into the camp. The Midianite army is confused. They end up starting to attack each other. And then what we saw in chapter 7 was that the Midianite army is fleeing. And the chapter closes with Gideon calling out to the men of Ephraim to come and control the area around the Jordan River to cut off the escape of this enemy. And then we see that the tribe of Ephraim actually gets the two princes of Midian, Oreb and Zeb, delivers their heads to Gideon. And everything looks like it's going really well for Gideon. In fact, I think if the book of Gideon ended right here, I think we would see Gideon as really probably one of the most heroic and faithful examples that we have in Scripture. I think that's why you see the Gideon Society, the people that put the Bibles in the hotel rooms. That's why they took his name to put upon their group, this very faithful man here within chapter 6 and chapter 7. But unfortunately, today as we look at chapter 8, we're going to see, is what Paul Harvey used to say, we're going to see the rest of the story. So chapter 8, verse 1. We come to God's holy and inspired word. Then the men of Ephraim said to him, what is this that you have done to us, not to call us when you went to fight against Midian? And they accused him fiercely. And he said to them, what have I done now in comparison to you? Is not the gleaning of the grapes of Ephraim better than the grape harvest of Abiezer? God has given into your hands the princes of Midian, Oreb, and Zeb. What have I done to be able to do in comparison with you? Then their anger against him subsided when he had said this. And so after Gideon has the tribe of Ephraim come in and sort of participate in the mop-up operations of this battle, so to speak, well, they're a little offended. They're offended that Gideon didn't call them and ask them to help earlier. If we look backward in Scripture, we would see that Joshua was of the tribe of Ephraim, and apparently this still led to this tribe holding themselves in very high regard here. And we'll see later in Judges chapter 12 with Jephthah that they once again kind of have this same issue, except for it doesn't quite work out so well for them then. And in that case, there's going to be about 40,000 people of the tribe of Ephraim that are killed. But here, Gideon, he does very well. He finds it's a good example of Proverbs 15:1, which says, a soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Hear what Gideon does. He says, what have I done in comparison with you? Is not the gleaning of the grapes of Ephraim better than the grape harvest of Abiezer? God has given into your hands the princes of Midian, Oreb, and Zeb. What have I been able to do in comparison with you? The term gleaning there, understanding that, is particularly important to really understanding what Gideon is saying there. You may remember in the book of Ruth, which is about the same time period as the book of Judges, that's how Ruth comes to meet and know Boaz, is that she's gleaning in his fields after the harvest. So what gleaning is, gleaning just refers to this activity of taking what's left by the reapers. In fact, God's law commanded those things to be left there and even the corners of the fields not to be harvested so that the poor, the alien, the needy within Israel would have food to eat. So here, what Gideon is saying is, Ephraim's leftovers, the stuff that's left on the ground, is better than the whole harvest of his tribe, his clan, the clan of Abiezer. Basically, Gideon says, hey, you guys got the big fish. You guys got these two princes. What was I able to do in comparison to you? It seems his strategy worked very well. Their anger is soothed. But we notice one thing here. We notice that there's not any mention of Yahweh. There's not any mention of God's calling Gideon, that this was his plan. He had commanded Gideon to act in this way. It seems as if there's already a bit of a downplaying of God's role within these things. Then in verse 4, and Gideon came to the Jordan and crossed over, he and the 300 men who were with him, exhausted yet pursuing. So he said to the men of Succoth, please give loaves of bread to the people who follow me, for they are exhausted. And I am pursuing after Zebah and Zalmunna, the kings of Midian. And the officials of Succoth said, are the hands of Zebah and Zalmunna already in your hand that we should give bread to your army? So Gideon said, well then, when the Lord has given Zebah and Zalmunna into my hand, I will flail your flesh with thorns of the wilderness and with briars. And from there he went up to Penuel and spoke to them in the same way. And the men of Penuel answered him as the men of Succoth had answered. And he said to the men of Penuel, when I come again in peace, I will break down this tower. So what we see in the case of the tribe of Ephraim was the men there, they were easily offended when they didn't get to participate in the way that they wanted. They wanted to be able to be kind of the front of the show, be seen by everybody as they participated in this battle. It's one of those things that there could be that temptation for us as Christians to want to have those gifts that are more visible. But we have to remember that God is the one who has determined each one of our giftings. Not everyone is a head, not everyone is a hand, not everyone's an eye, but all of us have giftings that work together to serve this body. So let us all serve faithfully where God has us, not looking to this person or that person, going, oh, I wish I had that gift, I wish I could serve in that way. That's what the tribe of Ephraim were doing here. But now, the men of Succoth and the men of Penuel, they're really more concerned about their own security rather than serving God and serving his people. And the cities of Succoth and Penuel, that's within the tribe of Gad on the other side of the Jordan. And so that we're going to see that I think impacts their thinking later. They're a little bit further separated from the other tribes of Israel, putting themselves in a more vulnerable position there. And the reality is, on one hand, we can sort of understand their hesitation. We'll see later in the text that of the original 135,000 of this army of Midian, there's 15,000 left. And so if you think about here, this army of 15,000 comes through, and then there's this little group of 300 of Gideon that comes behind them. And you know, you just think of just the comparison there, and the people in the city are probably thinking, well, okay, if we help our countrymen, if we help Gideon, then things go bad for him. The men of the army of Midian conquers, well, they're going to come back and then put retribution upon us for helping Gideon and his army make it through. But as we saw in chapter 7, the Lord wanted to make it absolutely clear to anyone with half a brain that it was him who had brought the victory there. Yet the 300 of Gideon, they had wiped out so much of this army that there's this, of the original 135,000, there's only 15,000 left. And the men of Succoth and Penuel, they would have seen this. So the reality is that they're not really doubting Gideon here. They're doubting God and what he has said. The men of Penuel, they're really trusting in this tower that would have been used as a defensive position. You know, as the town was brought under siege, people could flee into the tower, and then basically they would end up being able to, you know, dump stuff down on top of the people that were attacking them there. We'll see this play itself out in another chapter of Judges as well. The reality is that they weren't trusting in Yahweh. They didn't see him, as Proverbs 18:10 says, the name of the Lord, the name of Yahweh, is a strong tower. The righteous man runs into it and is safe. So how Gideon acts here, he clearly does remember the grace that God showed him earlier within this book. Just he so lacked faith, and God patiently showed him with the signs of the fleece and just carried him along in his weakness. And here he's ready to turn on his countrymen really at the slightest thing. He says to the men of Succoth, I'm going to take these thorns
of the desert shrubs. I'm going to flail your flesh with them because of what you've done. In the men of Peniel, I'm going to come back and I'm going to break down this tower. In verse 10, now Zeba and Zalmunna were in Karkor with their army, about 15,000 men, all who were left of the army of the people of the east, for there had fallen 120,000 men who drew the sword. And Gideon went up by the way of the tent dwellers, east of Nobah and Jogbaha, and attacked the army, for the army felt secure. And Zeba and Zalmunna fled, and he pursued them and captured the two kings of Midian, Zeba and Zalmunna, and he threw all the army into a panic. So again, we see that of the 135,000, only 15,000 of that army remain. Remember that Gideon starts off with 300 against that army of 135,000, and we talked about just the insane odds that that was. It would be, you know, a group about the size of this room going against, you know, the crowd that would come out of the biggest sports stadium in the country. I mean, it would just be foolishness. Well, here even still, there's 300 against the 15,000, which still, from a human perspective, one against 50, that's incredible odds. So I think it speaks to, even still, Gideon and these men have great faith in what God has promised. They're still following, still pursuing, yet they're exhausted. And here what happens is, Gideon appears to have his own brilliant military strategy. He comes and takes the caravan route, seeming to go around and cut off this army and surprise them. And this little group of 300 surprises the army and takes the two kings captive. Verse 13, then Gideon the son of Joash returned from the battle by the ascent of Heres, and he captured a young man of Succoth and questioned him. And he wrote down for him the officials and the elders of Succoth, 77 men. And he came to the men of Succoth and said, behold, Zeba and Zalmunna, about whom you taunted me, saying, are the hands of Zeba and Zalmunna already in your hand, that we should give bread to your men who are exhausted? And he took the elders of the city, and he took thorns of the wilderness and briars, and with them taught the men of Succoth a lesson. And he broke down the tower of Peniel and killed the men of the city. So what we see is that after this final victory, after this capturing of the king of Midianites, we see that earlier it wasn't just Gideon, you know, lost his cool for the moment. No, he comes bent on exacting his revenge against these two groups of men. So he begins by capturing a young man of Succoth, who gives him the names of the officials and the elders of the city. These would have been likely the heads of the clans, the ones that would meet often at the city gate and basically, like a modern-day city council, make decisions for these particular communities. So we see here that Gideon begins with the men of Succoth, and he fulfills that threat to take the thorns and the briars, and he disciplines them. And from the text, we don't know whether that means that they were threshed with these things, or it could even be that these thorns were laid out upon top of these men, and weights either put on top of them or maybe even dragged across them. But whatever, we know that this was a terrible punishment that Gideon exacted upon his people. But what we see is that these men actually got off lightly compared to the men of Peniel. What we see in that case is that Gideon actually goes beyond his original threat of tearing down the tower. He not only tears down the tower, he kills the men of that city. And the irony here is, if you remember back to chapter 1 of Judges, the great failure of Israel was they didn't drive out the Canaanites for the land. They had come in, they had conquered the land, but what God had commanded was that they were to push the people, they were to totally wipe the Canaanites out of the land. But even when they were able, even when they had the ability, they instead enslaved the Canaanites, they lived among them instead of killing them. And here, Gideon is willing to turn and do that upon his own people. As we've talked about, this is just another sign of this Canaanization of Israel. Verse 18. Then he said to Zeba and Zalmunna, "Where are the men whom you killed at Tabor?" They answered, "As you are, so were they. Every one of them resembled the son of a king." And he said, "They were my brothers, the son of my mother. As the Lord lives, if you had saved them alive, I would not kill you." So he said to Jethro, his firstborn, "Rise and kill them." But the young man did not draw his sword, for he was afraid, because he was still a young man. Then Zebah and Zalmunna said, "Rise yourself and fall upon us, for as the man is, so is his strength." And Gideon arose and killed Zebah and Zalmunna, and he took the crescent ornaments that were on the necks of their camels. So we see in this portion of the text, this mention of Tabor comes to us out of the blue. You may remember from Judges chapter 4 that Mount Tabor was where Barak, where God had told him to come and take his 10,000 men and basically set himself up on that mountain to draw out Sisera and his 900 chariots. But since then, we've heard nothing of this area within Israel. We've heard nothing of Tabor. But Gideon asked, "Where are the men whom you killed at Tabor?" So it seems that everybody here in this conversation knows what's going on, and we're about to be able to be let in on a little more detail here. So they answer him with what amounts to a backhanded compliment. They say, "As you are, so were they." So clearly they're dead now. Every one of them resembled the son of a king. So these kings have been in here saying, "Well, every one of them was like you. They were princely. They were like the son of a king. They weren't really kingly material like us." And so here, even within these last moments of their lives, they're sliding Gideon saying, "Well, you're still not quite up to where we are." And then we get this information that really surprises us, really, I think, makes us want to go back and reread what we've already looked at within chapter 8 so far. We see Gideon say, "They were my brothers, the sons of my mother. As the Lord lives, if you had saved them alive, I would not kill you." So now the truth comes out. We see that this pursuing of the Midianites and their kings across the Jordan, this wasn't about serving Yahweh. This wasn't about fulfilling what God had said. This was about revenge, pure and simple. This was Gideon fulfilling his own bloodlust against these kings because of what they had done to his brothers. So as we see that, hey, these 300 men had basically become what was a private and personal mercenary force for Gideon. It kind of makes us wonder, well, were the men of Succoth and Penuel, were they so wrong to deny help in this case to begin with? So we see that it wasn't about what Yahweh had commanded Gideon. It wasn't about seeking his glory. This was solely about Gideon. We saw that in chapter 7, verse 18, Gideon there is commanding his men. He says, "When I blow the trumpet, I and all who are with me, then blow the trumpets also on every side of the camp and shout, for the Lord and for Gideon." So at the time we noticed, hey, there was this little addition there. Maybe we can't think much about it, but here we see that it's now no longer about the Lord at all. It's only about Gideon. And then we see really a second surprise within the text here. I think that takes us off guard. We see that Gideon wants his firstborn son, Jethro, who's just a young man or a boy, to dispatch these two kings. It seems as if there's at least two things at work here. One, he wants to give his son this great honor of killing these two kings. And secondly, it would be very humiliating for these two men who thought themselves so great to be killed by just a boy. And what we see is that really his son, Jethro, resembles much more of Gideon from chapter 6, the scared, cowering Gideon, instead of this ruthless and vengeful Gideon that's come to us here in chapter 8. What we're going to see, unfortunately, in chapter 9, as Gideon's legacy unfolds, we're going to see that Jethro's half-brother Abimelech looks a whole lot more like the Gideon of chapter 8, very ruthless and vengeful himself. So Jethro refuses. The Midianite kings basically taunt Gideon and say, "Okay, Gideon, you play the man and do this yourself." And Gideon, he happily does it. In this, the section of the text, it actually ends rather oddly in a way that I think you wouldn't expect. He says, he took the crescent ornaments that were on the necks of their camels. So it kind of leaves us wondering, okay, what are we to make of this? And I think what we'll see, a very good principle at hand that we need to keep in mind, is so often when we come to Scripture, we come with something, okay, I'm not quite sure how to understand this. Well, if we just keep reading, that the text that we're in itself answers that question for us. If we'll just be faithful and pray and ask God to show us those things. So what we've seen is that Gideon's anger, his desire for revenge, is what's been fueling this coming across the Jordan, this coming after the kings of Midian all along. He's given full vent to this anger against the men of Penuel and against these kings of Midian. And in verse 22, then the men of Israel said to Gideon, rule over us, you and your son and your grandson also, for you have saved us from the hand of Midian. Gideon said to him, I will not rule over you, and my son will not rule over you. The Lord will rule over you. So we see here in verse 22 that the people of Israel, they want to reward Gideon for the things that he's done. And they actually have a couple of things right here. They recognize that their problem is long term. These deliverers, these temporary solutions haven't sufficed. They recognize that they need some kind of permanent change, and they're seeking after basically a monarchy here, a dynasty in Gideon and his sons. And then secondly, they have it right to see this connection between a deliverer and a king. But in spite of those things, notice that their focus is upon Gideon as the deliverer. Their focus is not upon Yahweh who delivered them, but rather is upon Gideon. The reality is that their problem was long-term. It was in fact eternal. But once again, they've missed this, that first and foremost, that their issue was a sin issue. The sin issue is what had led to their current misery, them following after the false gods of the land. In chapter 6, we see a prophet comes before Gideon and basically reminds the people of this, that this is about sin, this is about you following after these false gods. So in the end, they didn't have a Canaanite problem, they didn't have a Midianite problem, they had a sin problem just like us. They had a nature of sin that they had inherited from Adam. They had a record of sin, them doing sins in their own right. In their case, it was following after these false gods, these Baals that were in the land. But as I said, they had it right that they recognized, hey, we need something more than just a deliverer. And they basically attempt, without using the word, to set Gideon up as a king. But unfortunately, what we're going to see later, once Israel does institute a kingdom with Saul and David and the kings that will follow after, an earthly king is not going to suffice either. We need something beyond an earthly deliverer. We need something beyond an earthly king. So we see that Gideon's answer here is right. He says, I will not rule over you. My son will not rule over you. The Lord will rule over you. His answer is right, but it's incomplete. Notice what Gideon doesn't do. He doesn't correct this fundamental misunderstanding that they have, that it was not him. It was Yahweh who was the deliverer. It was Yahweh who had delivered them. Again, we saw in Judges chapter 7, verse 18, where Gideon says, when I blow the trumpet, I and all who are with me, then blow the trumpets also on every side of all the camp and shout for the Lord and for Gideon. So we see there that we had the seed of concern, this little red flag that we might have got in chapter 7 that now has come full bloom to it being about Gideon. Then the irony thing to me here is that the people of Israel are actually united here. But they're united in something that goes totally contrary to what God's word had said. It reminded me so much of the modern church today, and they're uniting around the LGBT agenda that's being pushed upon our country and our world today. There's this uniting around these things, but it's totally contrary to what God's word says. So we have to remember, brothers and sisters, that unity only comes in light of what God's word says. If we have unity that's apart from truth, we don't have true unity at all. Here, the people of Israel, they had Deuteronomy chapter 17 to show them what it would look like when they would ask for a king. Here the Lord says, when you come to the land that the Lord your God is giving you, and you possess it and dwell in it and say, I will set a king over me like all the nations that are around me. You may indeed set a king over you, whom the Lord, whom Yahweh, your God, will choose. So we see that clearly Gideon was God's chosen deliverer, but there was no indication at all that he was God's chosen king. The people of Israel run ahead of themselves again, not following after what God's revealed will was in his word. We see the same thing later in Saul, and we see the same disastrous results. Verse 24, and Gideon said to them, let me make a request of you. Every one of you give me the earrings from his spoil, for they had golden earrings because they were Ishmaelites. And they answered, we will willingly give them. And they spread a cloak, and every man threw in it the earrings of his spoil. And the weight of the golden earrings that he requested was 1,700 shekels of gold, besides the crescent ornaments and the pendants and the purple garments worn by the kings of Midian, and besides the collars that were around the necks of the camels. And Gideon made an ephod out of it and put it in his city in Ophrah, and all Israel poured after it there. And it became a snare to Gideon and to his family. So Midian was subdued before the people of Israel, and they raised their head no more. And the land had rest 40 years in the days of Gideon. So what do we see here? We saw it in verses 22 and 23 that the people say, Gideon, we want you to be our king. And Gideon says no with his mouth. But what do we see here in verse 24? We see, he begins by basically requesting tribute from the people of Israel. He says, give me all the golden earrings from the spoils of this great battle. And the people, they willingly comply. In verse 26, he gets 1,700 shekels of golden earrings. That's 43 pounds of gold that Gideon got here. And as a Friday afternoon in New York, that would have been worth over $829,000 worth of gold that Gideon got. It sounds to me like a really good start to a royal treasury. Then in verse 26, it harkens back to the text that we saw earlier about the ornaments around the camel's neck. It says, Gideon had collected the royal garments and the ornaments worn by the kings of Midian, in addition to the collars that were around the necks of their camels. So basically, it seems like in these kings of Midian, Gideon had his little king starter set and then begins to play the part all the while saying no with his mouth. No, I don't want to be your king. But he just begins immediately acting like the ruler that he's professing with his mouth that he doesn't want to be. Let's go back to Deuteronomy chapter 17, where God lays out restrictions, guidance for the kings that would come within Israel. In chapter 17, verses 16 and 17, there the word of the Lord says, only he must not acquire many horses for himself, or cause the people to return to Egypt in order to acquire many horses. Since the Lord has said to you, you shall never return that way again. And he shall not acquire many wives for himself, lest his heart turn away. Nor shall he acquire for himself excessive gold and silver. So basically what we have here is we have prohibitions on the kings of Israel to not act like the kings of the nations that would surround them. It was to not put their trust in horses, not put their trust in gold, not put their trust in political alliances by profaning marriage. So let's see how Gideon does here. Well, the first one, he must not acquire many horses for himself or cause the people to return to Egypt in order to acquire many horses. Okay, he actually seems to pass this based upon the text. The next, he shall not acquire many wives for himself. Well, we're going to see in verse 30 that he did have many wives. In fact, they gave birth to 70 sons. And I know that some of you think that we have a rather large family. Well, you think of 70 sons here. So Gideon fails this. He gathers many wives for himself, seeking this dynastic idea, all the while denying it. And thirdly, he shall not acquire for himself excessive silver or gold. We see that he failed that as well. We see that already from the very beginning, he amounts what is a great royal treasury here. So it seems what's happened is Gideon has become the de facto king. He's the king, in fact, even though he's denying that that's what he wants and that's what he is. And in fact, what's happened is he's not just become a king, he's become a king just like all the other nations around them. Again, this is another example of the canonization of Israel. And then what happens next? It actually gets worse. We see in verse 26 that Gideon takes this gold and he makes an ephod out of it. And what we have here, if you think back to Aaron in Exodus chapter 32, taking those earrings of the Egyptians and making a golden calf. It seems as if that's what we should reflect back on as we see this same thing happening again here. But what happens, instead of a golden calf, it's a golden ephod. So actually more syncretism, taking this garment that was commanded to be made by Moses and worn by the high priest. It was basically this outer garment that was sleeveless that would go over the high priest's other garments. It had four rows of precious jewels on it that represented the 12 tribes of Israel. It had a pocket or something to hold the Urim and the Thummim, which were used by the high priest to discern the will of God in it. So Gideon basically takes and makes this thing of gold and takes all this authority on himself. Because what we see in Exodus is we see that Moses was commanded to make this, and the high priest was commanded to be the one that used it. And so Gideon here, he's not Moses, and he's certainly not the high priest. Then what does he do with it in verse 27? And Gideon made an ephod and put it in his city in Ophrah, and all Israel whored after it there. And it became a snare to Gideon and his family. The irony is that Gideon takes this golden ephod and sets it up in the very place that earlier we saw him tear down the altar to Baal. So what we see in Gideon is he becomes the only one of the judges to lead Israel into apostasy and idolatry within his own lifetime. Then in verse 28, we have the familiar words that we've seen so often now. Midian was subdued before the people of Israel, and they raised their heads no more. And the land had rest for 40 years in the days of Gideon. In fact, we're going to see in the book of Judges, this is the last time that the land is spoken of as having rest. This spiral downward that we talked about, it seems to now be ever accelerating. But what we're going to see is that we haven't hit the bottom yet. And in fact, Gideon's story is not even finished yet. In verse 29, Jerubbaal, the son of Joash, went and lived in his own house. Now Gideon had 70 sons, his own offspring, for he had many wives. And his concubine, who was in Shechem, also bore him a son, and he called his name Abimelech. Here, some commentators, when they come to verse 29, they think, well, this indicates that Gideon went back into private life. He wasn't acting like a king at all. Well, what it seems to me is that Gideon just took his seat of power and moved it back to his own hometown. He sets up his golden ephod there. And so basically he has within his town of Ophrah the seat of political and military and religious authority. And we see, in addition to the many wives mentioned in verse 30, verse 31 tells us that Gideon has a concubine in Shechem who also bore him a son, who Gideon named Abimelech. So let's have a little Hebrew grammar lesson here. This word it's a compound word made up of two other Hebrew words. Abi means my father. Anybody want to hazard a guess what Melech means? Means the king, or is the king. So here we have this man who with his mouth says, no, I don't want to be king. Takes his son and names his son, my father is king. In verse 32, Gideon, the son of Joash, died in a good old age and was buried in the tomb of Joash, his father, at Ophrah of the Abizrites. As soon as Gideon died, the people of Israel turned again and poured after the Baals and made Baal Berith their god. And the people of Israel did not remember the Lord their God, who had delivered them from the hand of all their enemies on every side. And they did not show steadfast love to the family of Jerubbaal, that is Gideon, in return for all the good that he had done to Israel. I think as we look at the account of Gideon in chapter 8, it teaches us a number of things, one of which is one of the dangers of success, that being pride. Whether that be success in our own personal life, success in our marriage, success in our family, success at work, wherever we might find success, there is this temptation to think it was our power, it was our might, it was something good in us that brings this success to come to pass. We see that in Gideon's case. We see that Gideon thought this was all about him. He thought, hey, I'm the one that did all these things. Yeah, God may have helped a little bit along the way, but I was the deliverer. It was about me. Gideon had forgotten who he once was. Think back to Gideon chapter 6. Where did the angel of the Lord find Gideon? Found Gideon down in the wine press. So we have Gideon ducked down where can't even be seen beating out the grain there. He was a fearful man. And the Lord comes and says, oh, mighty man of valor. This prophetic statement about who Gideon would be after Yahweh comes and clothes him with the Holy Spirit and then girds up his faith with the signs of the fleeces. Gideon had forgotten who he was apart from God. Beloved, let that not be the case for us. Let us remember who we once were and who we would be even now if God hadn't come and granted us new life, if God hadn't come and made these dry bones live, as we saw last week. The reality is that once we come to a place where we think that God can't get along without us, where we think that we're indispensable to God and His kingdom, He's sure to show us just how wrong that we really are. What I see in Gideon, it's a heart-wrenching example of what it means to not finish well. We see Gideon starting off so well in chapter 7, doing mighty things for God, and then not finishing well. We see the example in 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles, so many of the kings to come would start off well. Solomon, Uzziah, Asa, Hezekiah, but they wouldn't finish well. I'm afraid so often in our day, it seems sometimes that there's just a constant barrage of Christian leaders, that men that look sound in their teaching, sound in living a life of godliness. They give in to temptation and sin, and they fall. They don't finish well. I see all these things, and it stirs in my heart, brothers and sisters, a desire, a longing to be one that finishes well. I want to be able to say with Paul, I've fought the good fight, I've finished the race, and I've kept the faith. Don't we all want to hear the condemnation or the commendation of Jesus? Well done, good and faithful servant. Last time when we looked at Judges chapter 7, we talked a little bit about some of the means of grace that God has given us. First of all, we talked about what those means are. First of all, we have to understand that they're means of grace. So they're means of God's unmerited favor that He would show us. But God in His Word has given us these, what one author has described as these channels, these showers of grace that flow down from God. And so we are to come and put ourselves underneath those if we want to fully experience His grace. Those are things like daily communing with Him, prayer, being amongst the saints. These means of grace, brothers and sisters, are essential for us if we want to finish well. We can't forget, we can't mix up justification and sanctification. The reality is that we will finish this race if we were in Christ. Brother Chris, in his teaching on the Trinity this morning, brought this out really well. He brought us to John chapter 10, where Jesus says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I will know them, and they follow me. I'll give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand." So I want to be clear that as we talk about the means of grace, this has nothing to do with our right standing before God. However well we excel, however much we fail, that no way impact our justification with God. We're talking here about sanctification, about growth in Christ-likeness. So among those means of grace that we looked at last time, that I want to bring out once again, first off is daily communion with the Lord through His Word and through prayer. We talk often about the priority of this in our lives because it bleeds out and impacts every other area of our lives. As we say, your spouse, if you're married, they don't need more of you. What they need is more of Jesus. Your kids, they don't need more of you. They need more of Christ. This church, these brothers and sisters, they don't need more of you. They need more of Christ. The lost world, that's what they need as well. They need more of Christ. They need more of you to be like Christ. And the means that God has given that are these means of grace. So first off, the Word. Psalm 1, verses 1 and 2. "Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night." As I came to this text, it got me to thinking, I wanted to go back and look at what the Word says itself will happen through the power of the Spirit as we come and read and meditate upon the Word. And here are just a short list of things. When we do that, brothers and sisters, our thoughts are taken captive. Our minds are renewed. Our ways are kept pure. It provides a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. So our path is illuminated so we might know the right way to go, and then we're guarded from going off that path. It enables us to rejoice in our persecution. It comforts us in our affliction. It draws us near to God. It compels us to bow down and worship Him, the thrice holy God. It drives us to lift up our hands to Him in praise. Then it preaches the gospel to us, ministering to our soul, reminding us who we once were and the hope that we have in Christ. I pray that we will be known as people of this book. Next, we have prayer. We see the two sides of prayer in 1 Thessalonians 5:17, pray without ceasing. And in Matthew 6:6, Jesus says, "But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you." Brothers and sisters, both of these things should exemplify our life. We should be this constant abiding as we're walking throughout the day in communion with God in prayer. There should be that time set aside communing with Him in prayer, seeking His face. I thought of the song that we often sing. It says, "Oh, what a peace we often forfeit, oh, what a needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer." Brethren, I pray that we would be known as a people of prayer. And lastly, we have the one another's. What I wanted to do is just highlight 5 or 6 texts just as an exhortation and reminder to us of what we're called to within this local church. So Hebrews chapter 10, 24 and 25. "And let us consider how to stir one another up to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together as the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near." So we're to stir one another up to love and good works. We're to not neglect to meet together, and we're to encourage one another. And notice here, I think there's a temptation for us with all the busyness that we have going on to say, you know, this gathering together, this not neglecting to meet together, okay, this was good in the first century, but today there's just so many things going on. So many things now, even on Sunday, whether it be work or sports or whatever might draw our attention. Not that those things are inherently bad, but the reality is, I think the temptation, the example that we see in the modern churchianity around us is, well, if something has to go in our schedule, it's the worship of the saints on Sunday morning. So let me encourage and exhort you that for many of us, there probably are things that need to go in our schedule, maybe long term, maybe week to week, but let me encourage you that the gathering of the saints should be at the bottom of that list if we place the same priority that God does in His Word. In James 5:16, therefore confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. So we're to confess our sins to one another and pray for one another. In Hebrews 3:13, but exhort one another every day, as long as it's called today, that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. So we're to exhort one another. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 11, therefore encourage one another and build one another up, just as you are doing. So we see there that we're to encourage one another, to build one another up. In Galatians 6:2, bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. And lastly, 1 John 3:16, by this we know love, that He laid down His life for us, that we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. So we should be laying down our lives for our brothers and sisters. Let me ask you, as we read these verses, does this exemplify the Christian life for you within this local body? Are these things a style of life happening in and amongst you as the people of God? If there's not, there needs to be a turning, a repentance, a seeing the priority of the local church that God gives us in His Word, in walking by His grace and fulfilling these things. The reality is that we must come alongside each other and fulfill these things if we're to finish well. Brethren, I pray that we would be known as a people for our love for one another that's evidenced as we walk these things out within our lives. So let's close today just by casting our gaze upon Christ, remembering that all these things, all these means of grace, they only come first by being in Him, by receiving Him, and then lastly, they only come as we look to Him. So turn with me to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, we're to begin in verse 32. So here in verse 32, we see that the writer of Hebrews commends Gideon that through faith, he was made strong out of weakness. He became mighty in war, and he put armies to flight. But then as we go down to verse 39, we see, and all these, including Gideon, though commended through their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had provided something better for us, that apart from us, they should not be made perfect. So let us glory in the fact that we sit on this side of the cross. We sit looking backward, seeing how God has redeemed us in Christ. And continuing in verse 12, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely. Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. So, brothers and sisters, our hope is not in any earthly deliverer. It's in a deliverer who did finish well. In fact, a deliverer who finished perfectly. This deliverer that came and lived that perfect life that we could never live. This deliverer that came and took the Father's wrath upon him that we justly and rightly deserve. That's the deliverer that we need. That's the deliverer that we need to cast our eyes upon, this author and perfecter of our faith. That's the hope that we have. The hope that we have is in Christ. So I pray that we'll look to him, we will cast our gaze upon him, but yet we will, as Paul says, discipline ourselves for the purpose of godliness, that we will let the love of Christ control us in walking out all these things, that we'll be known as people of the book, that we'll be known as people of prayer, that we'll be known as people that love one another, not just in word, but in deed, and that love will be manifested and seen by the world and all those that surround us. Let's go to the Lord and pray that he would work those things within each of our hearts. Heavenly Father, Lord, I just pray that you would help each one of us to run the race that you set before us, that you would help us to finish well. You have provided such a great cloud of witnesses. Let us be encouraged and taught by their example. Let us not look first and foremost to them. Let us look to Christ, the founder and perfecter of our faith. He endured the cross. He despised the shame. He's now seated at the right hand of the throne of God. I thank you for saving us. I pray that, Lord, for the saints here this morning, that you would use this word, plant it deep in our hearts, that you would build us up, that we might be made more in the image of Christ. I pray that we would heed the instructions from your word to one another's. But even this morning, as we have our time of fellowship where we turn and face each other, we would have that intimate time together, that we would examine ourselves and begin even now, Lord, seeing how we could build one another up to love and good works. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.